told you about the walrus and me. You know that we're as close as can be. Well, here's another clue for you all. The walrus was Paul. I told you about the fool on the hill. I tell you, man, he's living there still. Well, there's another place you can be. Listen to me. This is Carolina Hanks. Welcome, dear listener, to the Carolina Hanks Podcast, brought to you by Wreak Havoc Productions. I'm your host, Dan Sellers. North Carolina has a rich music history. Sure, the long-term contributions of Fred Durst, Clay Aiken, or Kelly Pickler may be debatable, but there's no denying the influences of artists like Ben Folds, Maceo Parker, Tori Amos, Doc Watson, Randy Travis, and Charlie Daniels. We've even produced some music legends like George Clinton, Nina Simone, Thelonious Monk, John Coltrane, and James Taylor. Today, we're going to explore the link between James Taylor and the death of the Beatles, John Lennon, and Paul McCartney. The Beatles were, of course, the biggest musical act of their day and perhaps the greatest of all time. As such, there have been a number of conspiracy theories about the Fab Four. Some of them were completely outlandish. There's a theory that the Beatles were a coven of witches. One about them summoning demons. One about connections to the Illuminati. One that Richard Nixon, Ronald Reagan, and Stephen King conspired to have John Lennon killed. One that the Beatles themselves conspired to kill their first drummer, Pete Best. And there were also claims that between 63 and 67, all of the Beatles had died and been replaced with lookalikes, or clones, or aliens. Supposedly, Ringo Starr died in 1963, George in 64, John in 65, and finally Paul in 67. The Beatles toured the United States twice, once in 64 and again in 66. Then they decided to stop touring altogether. Officially, they never played in North Carolina, but oddly enough, there are rumors that they played in Charlotte, Raleigh, and Greensboro. Perhaps we should add this to the list of conspiracy theories. And this is where James Taylor enters the story. James was very good friends with the Beatles. In 1968, Taylor was the first artist to be signed by the Beatles' record label, Apple. He moved to London to record his first album at Trident Studios. The Beatles were there at the same time recording the White Album. In fact, many of the days that the Beatles had booked at the studio, they spent working with James on his album. Taylor's song, Something About the Way She Moves, was an influence on George Harrison's writing Something for the Beatles. And conversely, Harrison and McCartney were a huge influence on Taylor's iconic hit, Carolina in My Mind.
In my mind, I'm gone to Carolina.
Taylor was feeling extremely homesick, and the Beatles suggested he write a song about it. The line in the song,
with a holy host of others standing around me,
was a direct reference to working with the Beatles in the studio. And in the original album version of the song, Paul plays the bass, and George provided backing vocals. The song didn't do much on the charts, but it was well received critically. It went on to become one of the most covered folk songs in history. It's also become the unofficial state anthem of the Tar Heel State. In fact, I'd be willing to say that more people are familiar with Carolina in My Mind than they are the actual state anthem. If, however, you're planning on carefully listening for George and Paul the next time you hear it, chances are you won't. Apple was very stingy with licensing for the song, and a new, more mellow version was recorded for Taylor's 1976 Greatest Hits album. It's this later version that is almost exclusively played today. Taylor was close friends with John Lennon, and that may have been a toxic relationship for the Beatles as a whole. Taylor's career had been riddled with tumultuous controversies, like domestic abuse and drug addiction. Taylor said once in an interview that he felt he was a bad influence on the Beatles and to John in particular. Taylor didn't introduce John to opiates, but the two often did them together, and John's drug habit was a big factor contributing to the breakup of the Beatles. In December 1980, John Lennon was living in New York City's Dakota Building. Just a block away, his neighbor was James Taylor. On December 7th, Taylor had an unsettling run-in with a man named Mark David Chapman while coming out of the subway. Taylor said he basically pinned him to the wall and was glistening with sweat and was talking some sort of, quote, speak freak about all the stuff he was going to do and how he was interested in meeting with John. The following day, James was in his apartment when he heard five quick bangs, which turned out to be the five gunshots fired by Mark David Chapman, killing John Lennon. As mentioned before, there were other rumors predating John's death that they had all died. Most of these rumors were short-lived, but the Paul is dead myth became as popular as the Elvis lives myth. According to Time magazine, Paul is dead is one of, quote, the world's most enduring conspiracy theories, end quote. The Paul is dead conspiracy theory goes something like this. On Wednesday, November 9th, 1966, Paul stormed out of a recording session after an argument with the band, and got into a terrible car accident. It was said that McCartney was decapitated in the collision. Well, being the biggest band in the world, this put the other Beatles in an awkward spot. It was decided that the world simply could not handle such a loss, and the band couldn't survive it either. So they replaced Paul with a lookalike. Enter Billy Shears. Billy Shears, who not only bore a striking resemblance to McCartney, but also wrote songs, played bass, and sang too. Within a year of the rumor, there would be many songs from other bands referencing the hoax, including The Ballad of Paul by the Mystery Tour. So Long Paul by Werbley Finster. We're All Pallbearers by Zacharias and His Tree People. We're all pallbearers. We're all pallbearers. St. Paul by Terry Knight and, of course, Brother Paul by Billy Shears himself. That's right, a.k.a. William Campbell, who allegedly was the new Paul. Back to the theory. As the story goes, the remaining Beatles felt guilty about covering up Paul's death and began hiding Easter eggs and clues in their songs and album covers, alluding to the truth. But the truth was that the Fab Four found the rumors amusing and played along with it. They were well known for including backmasking messaging in the music that can only be heard when the record is played backwards. After 1967, fans scoured their songs looking for clues, finding tons, or at least finding a way to make what was there relate to the conspiracy. Here's a very abridged list of the supposed clues that led to the conspiracy enduring for five decades. The line,
he blew his mind out in a car. He didn't notice that the lights had changed.
The opening line of She's Leaving Home, which highlighted the moment of the accident.
Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock as the day begins.
The suppression of the story in the news found its way into Lady Madonna.
Wednesday morning papers didn't come.
At the end of Strawberry Fields, Lennon can be heard muttering cranberry sauce. Or perhaps misheard as I buried Paul. Bury My Body and Oh Untimely Death appeared in the radio feed towards the end of I Am the Walrus, taken from a BBC production of King Lear. At the end of I'm So Tired, John Lennon mutters, Monsieur, 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 how about another one? When played backwards, this was interpreted by some as, Paul is dead, man. Miss him, miss him, miss him. And then there's the lines,
I'm sorry that I doubted you. I was so unfair. You were in a car crash and you lost your hair.
By Ringo's Don't Pass Me By. There's a sound of a car crash followed by an explosion in the song Revolution 9. The same song, when played backwards, is said to contain the repeated phrase, Turn me on, dead man. Also, several references were said to be found on the album covers following the accident. There were clues found on Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. The front cover spells the words Beatles and Flowers. Some people took this to say, Be at Liso, a reference to the Greek island the group were considering buying, actually called Leslo. An arrangement of yellow flowers below this is of a left-handed bass guitar, the instrument most associated with Paul McCartney. Some say the flowers spell out the name Paul. If a mirror is placed horizontally across the middle of Sgt. Pepper's bass drum, so it bisects the words, Lonely Hearts, the phrase I won, IX, he die can be seen. This was taken to mean 11-9, he die, a reference to the supposed date of death, November 9th. The album cover shows an open hand above McCartney's head, which in some religions is a symbol of death, signifying that someone will die or has recently died. At the bottom of the image is a statue of the Hindu god Shiva, the destroyer. His hand is pointing directly at McCartney. Original pressings of the album had the lyrics of the song along with a photo of the Beatles. In the photo, George Harrison's thumb points to the line, Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock, the alleged time of Paul's death. On the rear cover, Paul has his back to the camera, suggesting he's hiding his identity. Turning one's back is said to be a symbol of death in certain cultures as well. Then there's the Magical Mystery Tour. A number of photos in the booklet show McCartney without shoes, said to signify death. People tend to be buried without them. Paul is shown in military uniform in one picture, behind a desk on which sits a sign saying, I was. A still from the Your Mother Should Know sequence shows all four Beatles in white suits dancing. McCartney is the only one to have a black carnation in his lapel. The others all have red ones. A cartoon of Paul labeled The Fool on the Hill shows him with a crack in his head. And finally, the Abbey Road album. The cover of Abbey Road, said to make a reference to a funeral procession, with John Lennon dressed all in white as a priest, Ringo Starr in a black suit as an undertaker, McCartney again being barefoot, and George following as a gravedigger. McCartney was also out of step with the others, with his eyes closed. In the same picture, McCartney's holding a cigarette in his right hand. However, it was well known that he was left-handed, suggesting that an imposter was in his place. A Volkswagen Beetle in the background has a license plate, LMW28IF. LMW was taken to mean Linda McCartney weeps. And 28IF was interpreted to reference Paul's age if he had lived. However, at the time of Abbey Road's release in 1969, he would have been 27 rather than 28. The truth, whatever that means, or at least the Beatles' side of the story, goes something like this. First of all, Paul wasn't even in London on November 9th, 1967. Between November 6th and 19th, he was on holiday with his girlfriend, traveling through Kenya and France. But they acknowledged two real-life events that probably started the rumors. Paul was indeed involved in an accident. But it was in 1965, and he was on a moped. Of course, it didn't behead him. His only injuries were a chipped tooth and a split lip, and perhaps embarrassment. After this, Paul grew a mustache to hide the scar on his lip, and the chipped tooth can be seen in videos for Paperback Writer and Rain. The second incident is a little more involved. On January 7th, 1967, Paul, along with the Rolling Stones, Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, and Brian Jones, were interested in investing in some artwork. They met with the owner of an art gallery, Robert Fraser, antiques dealer, Christopher Gibbs, and his assistant, Mohammed Haji. The plan for the group was to meet at Paul's house, discuss investing in art, but also talk about specific pieces that would work in the space of Paul's mansion. Then they would go to Jagger's house and do the same, and so on. When they left Jagger's home in Hertfordshire, en route to Keith Richards' estate, Jagger wanted to show Paul his new car, so the two rode together and Paul had the assistant Haji drive his Mini Cooper. Along the trip, the group got separated and Haji was involved in a serious accident and hospitalized. Paul's Mini Cooper had been highly customized and well known to the locals, so it wasn't long before they just assumed Paul had been driving. Early on, the Beatles thought the rumor to, of course, be absurd. Lennon said, "It's the most stupid rumor I've ever heard. What did we do, stuff him and shave him? How could we do it? I don't understand what it's all about." And Paul mimicked his feelings, saying, "It's all bloody stupid. I was walking barefoot because it was a hot day. The Volkswagen just happened to be parked there." Ringo was a bit more matter-of-fact about it. "If people are going to believe it, they're going to believe it. I can only say it's not true." And the Beatles received an unprecedented surge in album sales, which opponents of the conspiracy uses to prove that it's a hoax, invented to increase sales. Since his death, many people have claimed to see or sense the ghost of John Lennon. John spent the last 15 years of his life in fear of assassination. In 1966, a psychic warned him that he would be shot while living in the United States. From that point on, John visited psychics and fortune tellers and attended seances on a regular basis. During one session, while he was visiting Greece, a psychic told him that he would be killed on an island. Thinking that she meant one of the Greek islands, he immediately canceled his vacation and returned home. This may have been one of the reasons the Fab Four backed out of the plan to buy one of the Greek islands. Lennon would, of course, be killed in 1980 on Manhattan Island while returning to his apartment in the Dakota. The same building that had been reported to be haunted since 1967, when it was used for the filming of Rosemary's Baby. Dance, 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 dance. Lennon himself claimed to see the ghost of a crying lady walking toward him, only to have her vanish in front of his face. At least two Dakota residents have reported seeing John standing in the doorway where he was killed. Yoko claimed to see him sitting at the piano in their apartment. In 1977, Lennon recorded a song called Free as a Bird. In 1995, his son Julian approached the other Beatles, and together they came up with a way to heal the hurt and animosity they held toward one another when they broke the band up. They got together to add their vocals to the song. Throughout the process, they all claimed to feel his presence there with them. During one of the playbacks on the track, they distinctly heard John's name in the studio as the song faded out. In 2009, two Italian forensic scientists ran an analysis of McCartney through their high-tech forensic computers. The two men had intended to squash the Paul is dead myth once and for all. However, comparing the images of Paul before and after the alleged car accident, they found that Paul's face did indeed appear different. They found several minute changes, including his ears, nose, and mouth. So, it seems the Paul is dead conspiracy lives on. Let's not forget the latest Beatles song, Now and Then, released in 2023, using a demo track recorded by John in 1980 and preserved by Yoko. Ringo and Paul got together to finish what could be called the final Beatles song. To learn more about this story, check out AllThat'sInteresting.com, Exemplar.com, RantNC.com, BeatlesBible.com, Ranker.com, and TheGuardian.com. This episode was researched and written by Jeffrey Cochran, and was produced and hosted by me, Dan Sellers. You can find everything about our production company, Wreak Havoc Productions, at our website, wreakhavocproductions.com. You can find the Carolina Haints podcast on Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, and YouTube. Please leave us a review and share it with a friend. This podcast is also brought to you by Carolina Haints, Inc., a nonprofit organization dedicated to promoting folklore storytelling throughout the Carolinas. You can help us on our mission by joining our team on Patreon. With monthly contributions of $5, $10, or $25, you can receive perks such as the Carolina Haints Map of Monsters and Legend, behind-the-scenes video series, and monthly mini-episodes that are exclusive for members. Just visit patreon.com/Carolina Haints to learn more. And I'd like to give a big thanks to our latest Patreon members, Lindsay McKeelan, and her awesome son, Davis. It means the world, guys, and we couldn't do it without you. You can find everything about us, including the Carolina Haints book and tour dates for upcoming appearances, on our website, carolinahaints.com. Believe it or not, we're already scheduling library speaking events and festival appearances for 2024. And stay tuned for a major announcement about our second Legends and Lore historical marker coming soon. And of course, you can now buy your very own beautiful Carolina Haints t-shirt or long sleeve from our good friends at Craporama. Just visit the apparel page on our website or theirs to get yours. Be sure to follow us on Facebook and Instagram simply at Carolina Haints. and feel free to contact us directly at carolinahaynes@gmail.com. We'll be back in 2 weeks with a new episode. Tune in then to hear more about those things that go bump in the night. Lennon.